And we will start soon with our second day in our pirate security conference. And yeah, we start with Kawa and Enno. Then we have Birgitta Veselin Popov, and then with Birgitta, we have a lot of interesting things today and to discuss, and I hope you will like it. Okay, Anya will introduce you, yeah, we'll see what happened today.
Thank you very much. So, welcome to the second day of the Pirate Party Conference. I will do the moderation today, like yesterday. If you got any questions, please just let me know. I'll be around every time. And I will have this microphone if there are any questions after the presentations. So, for the first one, you know, after the invasion of the IS in Kurdistan, we've seen profound changes. Not very much is left of the former prospering area. The Kurds kept the economy running, whilst the Iraqi army is fleeing. More than 2 million refugees are kept safe. Religious minorities, like the Kakai, get help there too. The IS is not only kept at bay, but driven out of several territories. But the next threat is already rising, as we already know. Shia militias, called the Hashd al-Shabi, are backed by the Iran. Kawa Prüfer and Enno Lenze will now give us information about the current situation between Tush Karmashtu and Erbil. Please welcome them. Stage is yours.
So, welcome. Okay, so we've done this talk. I did it like 3 years ago, 2 years ago, and now this year, and last year, third year in a row. And usually I'm just recycling my slides, my famous slides. I'm still not a wizard in doing these slides, but it's okay. And then you see that some of the subjects just don't change, and you can just reuse some of the slides every year again because the stories are still the same and only a little bit changed. So first of all, just very quick, who are we? I'm Enno, I'm a businessman from a tourist branch, while Kawa is a Peshmerga fighter in Kurdistan, Iraq. And we did a talk here last year together. And in the meanwhile, we were together in Kurdistan, but while I was there as a reporter again, this time Kawa was head of my security team, and the ministry sent him to keep me safe. And obviously he did a good job, because we are both back and still we have arms and legs and everything, and it was a tough job. So it's really good to have a guy like him with you when you're close to the front lines. So what happened the last 12 months? Just a brief overview and then we get in the details. We have the old false accusations against Peshmerga. That's the slide which I can use again and again every 6 months. Then we still have the talks about independence that started like 40 years ago, but it's getting more interesting. And then the big thing, the Mosul offensive, which took place at the beginning of this year and is in last year, and it's still running. Then we had the follow-up attacks on Kirkuk, and again a subject that's repeating, the badly equipped Peshmerga who have to take care of themselves. Then we have the road trip with the hero. I will get to that later. And then what will happen next? The maybe Kurdistan-Iran or Kurd-Shia militia war or whatever. So, first of all, what are we talking about? A big problem is you won't find an accurate, up-to-date map about the situation anywhere there. This is like the closest I could get from the live UA maps. You see the pointer. So here in the north is Turkey. This is Iran. This is Syria. And this is Iraq. And so the yellow areas are those who are occupied by the Kurds. And that's where it starts. They are not the Kurds. It's like talking about the Germans in the time of the Cold War. So there are different groups, which sometimes don't like each other pretty much. Then you have the areas which were are occupied or under control of the Iraqi army and including Shia militias, but that's only one color again. And then you have the Islamic State, the gray areas. But the problem is, it's not like that you have a closed front line and that when you're driving around in this area that everything is under control of the Iraqi army. It's more that in these areas, most of the villages and cities and most of the streets are under control, but it still means that people from the other armies or your enemies can slip through. So that means everywhere, like at this border regions or frontline regions, you could get in touch with Islamic State people. And between these two patches, it looks pretty okay because you have the Islamic State surrounded by enemies. But also that's not the truth. They are able to transport stuff between the different parts and so on. So it will give you a brief overview and an idea of how it looks like, but it's much more complicated in detail. So this this nice bomb here marks Mosul, and the red the white star on red ground is more or less where the front lines are now. This is Erbil, the regional capital, so the capital of the autonomous region of Kurdistan. And down here where you have the megaphone at the moment is Baghdad, where yesterday some 51 people were killed again by a car bomb. So just for a brief orientation. And so let's start. Same procedure as last year. I will only make this quick. Last year and the year before, I talked a little bit about the stories which went viral in the media about the Peshmerga who blow up the houses of Arab citizens to prevent them of coming back to the areas the Peshmerga just covered. The story is bullshit and it getting up again every like 6 months. And since I think 3 years now, I read the story 8 times from different organizations and stuff like that. And always, the source is the same single person. And I visited a lot of these areas because the stories were on the media while I was there, and I was talking to people in the exact villages which were, according to this, bombed away, and the Arab people were still living there. On the other hand, it makes no sense in a war zone to bomb the last remaining houses and then sleep on the street. It would be smarter to force the people out and sleep in there, so the story doesn't even make sense. Next recurring accusation is the Peshmerga are selling the weapons of the German army, the Bundeswehr. The story started in summer 2014, which is very funny. That was before the weapons were delivered. So they start selling them before they were delivered. So it seems to be like on the crowdfunding sites where you start selling the stuff before you got them or something like that. And then it went on and on and on. And at the end, they found a total of 2 weapons, which have been sold by not by Peshmerga, by other people, while the... And 3 more lost in combat, and 2 sold, while the Bundeswehr at the moment is missing 190 assault rifles in Germany, because that happens when you have tens of thousands, and while the American army is short of 200,000 assault rifles in Iraq alone. So that means getting 2 weapons lost, that's okay, I think. So, but the stories are on the media again and again, that's why I'm talking about them a little bit, but it's boring because it's the same stuff always. So, next thing, that's a long one, the independence. That was a very funny interview. The Prime Minister was asked, what about the independence? And he said that they have to have a dialogue with Baghdad about the independence now. And then the journalist asked, and what if they don't want to have the dialogue? Then he said, well, then it's going to be a monologue. That's pretty simple. But in the years before, they were the Kurdish regional government was more careful. They said, yeah, we have to think about changing the way the politics work and the organization and stuff like that. And in the last month, they really say, independence, let's talk about it. Not if we do it, but how we do it. And so in these days, I think today or tomorrow in the morning, the President of the Kurdistan region of Iraq, Masoud Barzani, and the president of Iraq will meet here in Munich and talk about that again. And so it's getting closer, but from the outside it's hard to say how close it is. But since now years, the Kurdistan autonomous region of Kurdistan is financing itself. They have their own military forces, police forces, and so on. So basically they know how to run a country, they can keep their border safe, they can host 2 million refugees while having 5 million citizens. So basically it's a running country on its own, and they could declare independence. It's not like in other areas where people say, well, I would like to have independence, but I don't know how to do it. And then there were in the last years talks again and again. Now it's a little bit unclear what happens in the US. As far as I heard it till now, Trump is a friend of the Kurdish administration and of the Peshmerga, but we're not sure about that yet. With the old administration, they were okay with the independence, as well as Israel and the European Union. Israel definitely stated they will accept the independence of Kurdistan, while from different European Union countries, they didn't say they want to have it, but they say they like it's an internal issue of Iraq and you have to decide it on your own. But that does not mean that you will have a united Kurdistan with the areas in Turkey and Iran, Iraq and Syria, but it's only the area which is now under control of the Kurdistan regional government in North Iraq. But that's also a little bit tricky because they expand their territory in the last years. The areas where the Iraqi army was fleeing was covered by Peshmerga fighters, and so it's now under control of the Kurdish regional government. And they said they don't want to withdraw because they kept the area safe for the last years, and they fought and driven out the Islamic State. So they don't see a reason of driving out the Islamic State and then giving it back to Baghdad, which Baghdad wants at the moment. They say, thank you, but we were just away for like the last 2 years of war, but before we were here, so please give it back to us, and of course including the oil fields, and please pay us the money you made with the oil fields in the time you had it under control. And of course, I don't think that's gonna happen. On the other hand, the central government in Baghdad is very weak at the moment. Since I think a few months you can go to Baghdad by car again, that wasn't possible for nearly 2 years. And they don't have power over their country. They have power in Baghdad and in some areas, and they have basically the commander-in-chief of the army, but sometimes they run away instead of running to the enemy and stuff like that. So it's very unstable, and if you see the 50 people getting killed by a car bomb yesterday, it shows you that even the capital is absolutely dangerous, while the capital of the Kurdistan area is completely safe. In the last 2 years they had one bomb in there, and that was in front of the American embassy. And so you see a big difference there, and it's still today it's even safe to go to holiday in the Kurdish area. I will do it in a month again, and I try not to get to the front line this time, but most of the area is completely safe. Only the front line is dangerous, but the shopping malls are open, the you can go to the roller coaster in a park, you can see historic sites and stuff like that. So most of it is really safe, while the rest of Iraq is a big mess. And so even if Baghdad doesn't want them to declare independence, they can't put economic pressure on them, they can't put military pressure on them, so it's very hard. Now, the big thing last year and this year is the Mosul offensive. Basically, the Mosul offensive started nearly 10 months ago, but only with a few US Marines with big artillery, and they start pounding from the south of Mosul to clear area from the Islamic State and to make it like a big area where nobody lives and where you can't drive with big cars and stuff like that, to cut off the supply line. So that happened in the south. And in the west direction, Syria, Peshmerga fighters and especially the Yazidic fighters in the Shingal Mountains cut off the supply lines from IS there, but so the Islamic State moved southbound till they were able to still pass their ammunition and guns and so to Mosul. So it started a long time ago. And then there was a lot of negotiation between the Kurds and the rest of the Iraqi government. And then it was a really big mess. Because first of all, you have the Peshmerga fighters, but it's not like in the Bundeswehr, one big army and one guy who can, or at the moment, one woman who can give the orders. But it's more like two big groups and some smaller groups. And then you have the Kurdish fighters from Syria, who were in some parts around Mosul as well and said, we want to participate, the YPG. But the YPG are friends of the PKK. So some people said, well, you can't fight IS with the PKK because, or with friends of the PKK, but some people just say it's the same. Because then you're dealing with terrorists fighting other terrorists, and that's not how it works. So on the other hand, nobody wants to send somebody home who's willing to help. And so they had to have lots of negotiations within the different Kurdish fighters. And then it started with the Iraqi army. The Iraqi army is not allowed to enter Kurdistan, Iraq. By constitution, it's forbidden. At least as long as they are armed, they can go there for holidays and stuff like that, but not as a soldier. So they had to ask for special permission to enter the Kurdistan area to get to Mosul. And that was a very long discussion. Basically, do you want to do that or not? And then some 8,000 Iraqi soldiers get the special permission to get through. And the next thing was there are the Shia militias. In detail, I will tell you later, the Hashd al-Sha'bi. And then you had a bunch of groups who don't like each other, but who have to fight the same enemy. And then it got very tricky, and for a month they were in a deadlock because everybody wanted to join, but some people didn't want to work with others. And that delayed the Mosul offensive for a long time. And at the end, they made this plan of basically doing it in two legs. The first one is that the Peshmerga will go to the city outbounds of Mosul from the east, and they will conquer everything between Erbil and Mosul, all the little villages and that stuff, because that's what they can do best. And then there is the house fighting in Mosul, which nobody wants to do because it's very, very messy. And so everybody said, okay, we will keep that for the Iraqi army, who had more or less no choice to agree because they can't say, no, we want to do the easy part, but we are the cooler army, so let's do us the easy part. So Iraqi army had to do it, but they're not very happy with that. And they're not too experienced in that. The time when Saddam fought people in the cities and is long ago. The soldiers now are like 20, 30 years old. They have no experience in doing this. And if you see the security of Ava Damon, the CNN correspondent who got into Mosul at the beginning, it was a Golden Brigade, like the elite troop of the Iraqi army, and they lost half of the security team. They got killed. They got trapped for 28 hours in Mosul. And when you see the footage, they opened the doors of the armored vehicles. That's something you just don't do. As long as you're in an armored vehicle, you keep the doors shut. But they opened the doors, and then they got out to take a selfie in Mosul. That's how you get shot. And then you think, that's the elite troop of the Iraqi army? Seriously, people leaving an armored vehicle to take selfies? Okay. It's not that
and
the Peshmerga...
Yeah. The Iraqi government even said that the Peshmerga is not allowed to participate in the fight in Mosul from door to door. So this is something the Peshmerga didn't say, we don't gonna do it. They was not allowed to go into it from the Iraqi government.
But also I don't think they're not, they, if someone else could do this part, they would be happy, because the next thing is, in Mosul, most of the citizens are Arabs. And why ever, Kurds and Arabs are not the best friends since centuries. But that basically means if you're invading an Arab country, as an Arab city as a Kurd, then the people don't want you there. You don't want to be there. So it makes no sense. So it's better to keep it for the Iraqi army. It's not that the Peshmerga fighters are not doing selfies in front of armored vehicles or stuff like that. They don't do it because they don't have armored vehicles. They do it in front of unarmored vehicles. I saw that a lot. But they're not the elite group of the Iraqi army. That's the difference. So, but that means Mosul offensive, this two-leg strategy worked. And you had the Peshmerga from different parts, the KDP Peshmerga, also called the Barzani Peshmerga. They did a lot of the stuff, but also the PUK Peshmerga worked in the around Mosul, where usually they're not too much there. They're more in Kirkuk and in the south. And the KSDP Peshmerga under Kakahama, one of the big war heroes, he has only a few thousand, but all of them work together. And it's like always, they are fighting each other in discussions in political situations within Kurdistan, Iraq. But in the moment they have a common enemy, they work together like a charm, everything works. And so that worked pretty well. A bit funny from our point of view is that the Peshmerga basically have some kind of working hours. They said on this day we want to cover 4 miles, 5 miles, whatever. So they started when the sun got up, and when they finished their day work, they rest. And sometimes there was, we got the news like at 2 p.m. like, yeah, we finished our target for today and now let's have some tea. Then you say, but it's war. It's like, you can't say, okay, we continue tomorrow in the morning. But they said, well, that's the way we do it since always, and it works. So it's a bit weird for me, but they did it and they did a pretty good job.
And you've got night vision, that's also a good part.
But okay, without night vision, but you could work till the evening. But they say, no, let's make like milestones you want to accomplish and then you stop. And they did it when they fought Saddam several times, and so they said it's the way we do it. So this particular part of the war got a lot of media attention, and I think for two very simple reasons. First of all, everybody knows Mosul, but only a few people know Tuzkomatu. So if you say, I'm going to Tuzkomatu, they say Afghanistan, Iraq, Syria, where is it? And Mosul, everybody knows about. Next thing is, it's easy to get to Mosul. From Munich, you have a nonstop flight, 4 hours, then you're in Erbil, and then it's like 1 hour by car, maybe two, depending on the road conditions. Then you could just take your footage there, and you can get back on the same day and sleep at home again. And people did that, really. So they arrived at, I think, 4 in the morning, were at the front lines at 6 when the sun got up, did a little bit of filming for 2 hours, mostly staged, but who cares? And then they got back with the evening flight. Problem solved. And then it's not too expensive for your company. But there were also a lot of people, especially CNN, and like I always telling you, the Bild-Zeitung in Germany, it's even if most people don't like it, I say it's fine if you don't like the Bild-Zeitung, but they had two people there for weeks. And so every other newspaper who's yelling at the Bild-Zeitung should have more people there for a longer time before starting yelling. And that means there was a lot of media coverage. And when I asked the people, okay, and so you're also going to Kirkuk and Tuzkomat, where the other fightings are? No.
What's that?
No, it's the other street, and we don't have a map, and I want to sleep in my 5-star hotel, and too complicated. And nobody knows about it. So I did it. But no, not because of that, but because I was late. When the Mosul offensive started, of course, I got a message in the night like, okay, we start tomorrow. And I was like, yeah, but, you know, I have a regular job. I have my day job. So it took me 2 weeks to be ready to fly there. And then they said, well, 2 weeks, sorry, we're done. At least the Kurdish troops. And seriously, I don't trust the Iraqi army. I think they should attend to the Olympic Games more often because they are good in running from the enemy. But as long as you're not a good runner, you shouldn't join them. And I saw it several times when people I knew went with them, and when the CNN team went with them, I told them I wouldn't do it. I just don't trust the guys. And it ended up in being 28 hours trapped and killed half of the security team. So that's why I said, okay, I'm not going there as long as the Iraqi army is around, so I'm going south. And because there was a lot of pressure in Mosul, IS tried to attack the cities more in the south, like Kirkuk, which is also a very important and big city, to see if they can get some ground there. So that's one of the pictures I got in courtesy of Bild. This is the actual front line, and just to explain it, because sometimes it's a little bit funny. This is a sniper. You can see his scope here, and you see how badly the front lines are. You have this earth wall, and then you have the sandbags, and that's it. That's all what protects you. They don't have bulletproof vests and nothing. This is Klaus Weinmann from the Bild-Zeitung with a class 4 or level 4 bulletproof vest and his helmet, and he was taking pictures and they were shooting. And then they realized that there is a journalist nearby taking pictures, and they said, "Hey, are you thirsty? You look tired. Here, let's have a Red Bull." Or a Tiger, yeah, the local energy drink. And so they said, yeah, we have to support the journalists because it's so exhausting for them to work here and they look so tired, so we have to take care of them besides shooting ISIS. And that's really, yeah, it's really kind, but it's somehow weird. But stuff like that happens all day long. And then you had the Mosul offensive, which is basically the Eastern Front, and there was a lot of media, but it's really dangerous. Even when there are a lot of cameramen and they are doing their footage and you see them giving interviews, it looks like nothing happened, but it's really dangerous. Also in the CNN footage, while they were giving an interview, some bullets hit the car behind them and they had to get to the ground while doing a live interview and stuff like that. So even that looks funny and nice, but in the next moment a motor could hit the people. And so it's complicated, because when you're there, often the whole day nobody is firing a single bullet, nothing happens, you're sitting around, you have tea, and in the next moment hell breaks loose, but you never know when it happens. So it's very, very complicated. So IS was pushing south. Kirkuk, Hawija and so on were under attack. And the first thing I saw that Facebook was activating the security check for Kirkuk. Seems a little bit odd, because war's going on there or around it since a long time, and some of these areas were under control of the Islamic State. So as an Islamic State fighter, you say, "I'm safe in Kirkuk, I'm fine, thanks mommy." But it's the first time I saw that, so I thought it's, yeah, interesting. When they attacked Kirkuk, there were only a few people basically attacking it, and you had sleepers in the city. And just to have one picture of how fighting in a city looks like, it looks sometimes like this. A bunch of guys hiding behind rocks, that's it. But Kawa was on site and fighting, so he could explain a little bit. Kirkuk.
The attack on Kirkuk started at 2 or 3 o'clock in the night. They was preparing themselves to attack and get some ground in Kirkuk, because they was thinking that all the forces, all the Peshmerga, everybody left the south area and went to Mosul. So they came from Hawija and they was hiding in refugee camps. Then they activated the sleeper cells in the city. They meet up and they started. It was like 130 to 135 attackers. This whole fighting in Kirkuk was going on like 1 week. It was very fast finished, like 2 or 3 days ago, after 2 or 3 days. And after that, they was collecting information and everything from the people, so they find the other ones were still in the city. Kirkuk is safe, and they put all the ISIS members who they got killed on the street to show them, "This is not the area you want to come again. We are all prepared. We will fight together and defend the city." Our luck in Kirkuk was that the civilians took up the arms, took the weapons, and went outside to help. Even the Peshmergas, everybody came, the veterans and kids and everybody went to the street. There's a lot of videos out there. You can see how Peshmergas died just in front of other people's. There was a lot of sharpshooters in Kirkuk, and we had also Akko, that's a guy. I know he will tell you about it. He saved like 75 people over there, and they was wounded, and there was like 75 people, they got killed. So he got all of them out there.
So, but this picture shows you urban fighting or war zones doesn't always look like you assume they look like. And the problem in Kirkuk was, if you're on the open field, then you see your enemy in advance, and you see when he's driving around, you see like the dust and stuff like that. It doesn't help if you don't have a rocket launcher, then you just know that you're gonna die and you can't do anything about it. But it's still different. And here first you have to see, is this an enemy or is this my friend? Especially when everybody get up the arms and everybody's running around, then you have to ask, are you trying to shoot me or are we shooting the others together? And the other thing is just like entering a building. Whenever you played like paintball or stuff like that, you realize that even entering a single room is very complicated without getting shot, and cleaning a whole city, the big problem. So the German Bundeswehr start helping the Peshmerga, not with fighting, but with the training in Erbil. And they set up a training facility, which is basically they used unfinished houses and more or less finished them in an easy way. And then they trained the Peshmerga in doing house fights. That's also, it's complicated because on one hand, do we want Bundeswehr people to train people in other countries to do good house fights? And on the other hand, if we don't train them, nobody's doing it, or the Americans are doing it. And then you have the influence of America again, which a lot of people don't like. So one way or the other, you have to make a decision. So, and what Kawa already told you, they put the dead bodies on the street and even some in the trash bins. When we were in Tuskurmatu, sometimes it's complicated to get the translation over several languages. If one guy is talking Arab and another is talking Arab and Sorani, and one Sorani and English, and then I get it in English. And the question was basically, do you want to see some IS fighters? And we said, well, yes, because we expect that they captured them and maybe we could talk to them. And then they opened like a trash bin. We said, okay, sorry, something was messed up in the communication. And one thing is, nobody wants to bury them. Nobody wants to do the job because they hate them. So nobody wants to work for them. And on the other hand, even it's very cruel, if you do it with so much disrespect, in the lines of ISIS, the people want to die as heroes and they want to get their virgins or whatever they believe in, but they don't want to end up in a trash bin on YouTube. So it's really discouraging ISIS fighters. I couldn't imagine that before, but a lot of people told me so, that if you're laying, like they told me, like a shot dog on the street, then you didn't die honorful. And so that's a problem for ISIS guys. So if you see images like this, of course it's, for us it's cruel, but for the people there, it's some kind of fighting the war and discouraging ISIS fighters. So, a big problem there was the bad equipment. This was one Humvee we saw later, but the one in our base. So when I was there the last time a few months ago, of course I was there with Kawa, and in our base we also had Humvees, but in a slightly better shape, but only slightly. First of all, usually the Peshmerga attached this very big plates here to keep the car safe. The next thing is, these are like the big machine guns, not the ones you have in the hand, but the big ones you have on top of a car, like a douche car or a 50 caliber. So really the big stuff with like these bullets. So the really big windows, and you have two of the windscreens behind each other, they hold it. But then you should get to the garage and get new windscreens, because of course it won't hold too many shots. And that's a problem, they don't have any spare parts or anything. So at the when your car is hit the first time, you said, well, I'm in a very good armored vehicle, I'm fine. And the next shot you say, okay, now it's not so stable anymore. And you basically say you can hold like 4 to 5 bullets. It depends on a lot of stuff, but somehow that's the rule of thumb. So this already got 3. So it's very likely that the next bullet will hit the driver. And then they will still drive around with the car, maybe with a steel plate here or something, because they have nothing else. So these cars were captured by ISIS. So the Americans left it for the Iraqi army. Iraqi army somehow lost it to the ISIS. And I say lost because when you're losing 500 cars on a parking lot on one day, it's a bit suspicious. When 2 years ago I arrived at Kirkuk Airport, there was still the full parking lot with all the parked armored vehicles and ammunition and stuff like that. And the Iraqi army just left. In that case, Peshmerga were first, and so they captured a lot of these cars. But they say, isn't it weird that you keep the armored vehicles with the ammunition there while fleeing? So Peshmerga got a lot of them, but old, no service, and so on. And yeah, somehow you have to deal with it. And then, how does a front line looks like? I told you it's pretty simple. So this is one of the front lines where we were. And everything that keeps you safe are the sandbags and this earth wall. In this case, it's about 3 meters high. And then you have a guy, in this case it's a Kawa's M16, and it has a scope that's very rare. So you see it's really... yeah, really sad there. And then you're standing around there whole day long, 12 hours, 14 hours, looking into the desert and wait that something happens. And then you get tired and you're not watching closely, and then somebody can attack you. And at night, you don't have night vision and you don't want to switch off on lights, because then everybody knows where you are. So you're sitting in the dark waiting. And also, refugees are arriving there. When we were at that site, they told us, yes, sometimes at the night they see something moving, but they can't just fire, because sometimes it's refugees who made it out of ISIS areas. And sometimes it's somebody who looks like a refugee, but it's a suicide bomber. So you have to decide in the dark with no backup forces or anything, with no night vision, do I kill him or not? And when we were there, a really old lady, looked like at least 100 years old, arrived on a really small motorbike with a trailer with a big pot of soup. In Germany, we call it a Gulaschkanone. And then she started feeding the Peshmerga and went to the next part of the front line, to all the bases, and then went back. And she said, well, I have to cook for the boys because their mommy isn't here. They don't know how to do it. And they have nothing to cook. They have no food, nothing. So the old lady is passing by every day and feeding them, because otherwise they don't have anything to eat. And so the system works, but you see, everybody has to do his job somehow. It's yeah, it's not like when the Americans go to war. So now imagine you're a Peshmerga, you have no money, you have no equipment, but your friends are dying. Akko, this guy, he looks, I think, pretty old. I expected him to be like 40, but actually he's younger than me. He's slightly above 30 now. And he worked with the Americans in Baghdad as a translator. And in his time in Baghdad, he acquired this car, a BMW 7 Series E38, armor class B6, B7. That means it was sold in Germany, and very likely it was used for some kind of federal police or something like that, for transporting important people, so like politicians or something. But it was built in the 90s for urban environment. So like on the Munich Security Conference, if you're a minister, you get in one of these cars and get a transfer from the airport to the Bayerische Hof 20 years ago in Germany. So now he's using this car at the Islamic State front lines, and it's not built for that. And he has no money to service it because he quit his job to help on the front lines. So,
as a volunteer.
So he can sleep in the base, he gets rice and soup, and that's it.
And ammunition.
Yeah, and ammunition sometimes. But the problem is, even if Arko gets ammunition, he has no weapon because he can't afford one. He has a baseball bat with a few very big nails in it, and it looks a bit like Road Rage or Mad Max or stuff like that when he gets out with his very big baseball bat. And but the way he looks, I trust him that he would beat ISIS guys to death with the baseball bat, but it's not very helpful in a war. So, and what did he do when the attacks were in Kirkuk? He jumped into his car, meet his friend Abbas, and said, "Abbas, we have to go to Kirkuk because I have an armored vehicle and we have to get out the people." So he drove into the fights. They opened the doors, pulled in some of the guys laying on the street, and got to the next hospital, throw them out, and got back. While they were doing it, they got a lot of hits. You see it here. And they were pretty lucky. The windshield could withstand the AK-47 bullets, but also like four or five times, maybe six, you don't know. And he got a hit directly in front of his head. And in total, there were 18 bullet holes in the car. And really, I've never seen something like that on a civilian vehicle. I know military vehicles which were blown up, but the civilian vehicles, armored vehicles I saw, had like one or two shots, and then they got out of service and you sell them because you don't trust them anymore. And this one has 18, and because it was the only car left, they kept going. Till they got more than 70 people out. We couldn't get the exact figures because they said we don't know, but the hospital said we got some 65 out of that car alone, but they could only take in one or two at a time. So they did the tour like 20-30 times into the bullet and back and forth and back the whole day long, with not even having money for gas. So the gas station said, okay, of course I will sponsor the gas, but I'm not coming with you. And so, if they get killed or something, their families are lost. Nobody will pay them anything for that. The car is in a very, very bad condition.
And he's still using it.
Yeah, and he's still driving around with it. And while we were there, a friend of mine, Fidelis Kler, was also in Erbil, and he's developing and building and selling armored vehicles since 27 years, so he knows about the stuff. And I asked him if he could get there, and he sold cars to Kazai and to people like that. And so I said, okay, it's not exactly Kazai, but he's much cooler. Can you get to Arko and help him with the car? And he said, well, in my 27 years, I've never seen a vehicle damaged like this. And he was everywhere. And so he said, well, just set it on fire, fan the flames, and walk away. That's the only thing you could do with this car anymore, because the brakes are done, the engine is leaking everywhere with every fluid.
Bullet holes,
yeah. Yeah, that's a problem. When you have bullet holes in your engine, then fluids start leaking, even if you put gaffer tape and stuff like that on it.
You put a screwdriver into the hole to fix it up.
But it's driving. Fidelis said, can I drive it? And so they went for a drive, and Fidelis wrote a text of it, which was called Road Trip with a Hero. And he said, well, the car is still doing more than 200 kilometers per hour, even on the bad streets, with the bad brakes and engine and everything. And when Arko is driving, while he is handling two mobile phones and smoking a cigarette, it still feels safe because he's a good driver. And so the idea was, how can we help Arko? And first idea was, BMW, do you want to sponsor a new car? It's a bit tricky. Basically, yes, but somehow no. at the end, we didn't get very far there. So we said in the next day, we will just start a fundraising and said, okay, nobody wants to fundraise like a weapon for Peshmerga or stuff like that, but an armored vehicle for somebody who saved more than 70 people and is willing to do it again. I think we can make something. And even when we announced it like on Twitter, yeah, we want to start, three guys said, okay, I will give you 2,000 euro, 2,000 euro and 1,000 euro. So we have the first 5,000 euro before even starting. So we said, okay, that's fine. But this is like only one guy, but he's one of the biggest heroes there, of course. But you see how devastating the people are because they want to save lives and they just don't know how to do it because they have nothing. Next thing is they get refugees, lots of them. At the moment, they have about 2.5 million refugees and IDPs, internally displaced people who came from Iraq, but it's the same, people fleeing from war and you have to pay for them and feed them. So it doesn't matter, it's just you have the stamp IDP or refugee. And they're not only fleeing Islamic State, they're also fleeing the Shi'i militias, the Hashd al-Shaabi. And we talked to kids, like a bunch of kids, and a lot of them are very well educated and they speak English way better than I do. And they were correcting me all day long. And then, but very friendly, they tried to teach me a better English in the refugee camp. And then I was talking to them and one of them was like 10 or 11 years old. And I asked him how he got there, where his parents are. And he said, well, don't know. But he said, well, our parents were probably dead and they were in Fallujah. So close to Baghdad, 150, 200 kilometers from where we were. And he said then, because he was the older one, he took the younger ones and they just joined a track of refugees and start walking direction Kurdish area because everybody knew there you're safe. So the good thing were they were not passing the Islamic State territories because then they would be enslaved. They passed Hashd al-Shaabi territory, but they said for at least for children, refugees, they don't care about them. They're not helping them, but they're not fighting or enslaving them either. You have like a somehow safe passage, but you have to get through. And sometimes families there said, okay, we are also poor, but we can afford like feeding one or two children. So if you're alone or if you're only two siblings, stay here and we will try to help you and the rest keep walking. So after about 1 week, you finished the about 200 kilometer walk and then they arrived in the Kurdish areas and like on that checkpoint there between 200 and 1,000 people are arriving there every day and there are two or three guys at the checkpoint who have to manage it and there's not a big organization, it's not organized like here that you call your XO and said okay what do I do with them, it's you have to take care of them. Then you have to organize people to drive them around or you have to say it's that direction, please keep walking another 50 kilometers to the refugee camp or stuff like that. And then at one point they arrived in the refugee camps and the refugee camps are in pretty good shape. So you have enough food, enough to drink. It's not the nicest food. It's like a little bit of soup and rice, but it keeps you alive. You have medical facilities. So you can treat basic medical problems and you have a kindergarten and a school. And the one camp we were in had like, I think 3,000 people living there. It's a really small camp. The bigger ones have like 50,000 to 100,000 people in there. And they run the 3,000 refugee camp with two people who are somehow paid. And the rest are refugees because they say, well, they're refugees, they're not morons. So you ask, did you run a big company or an organization? So you have to help us. If you were a teacher, teach the others. If you're a nurse, help the nurse and stuff like that. And then it's self-organized. And they, in that particular camp, they had, I think, 400 or 500 children because they said, send all the children to one camp, then we can focus on them. Especially to treat them psychological, because they said, okay, if it's bleeding, put a plaster on, that's simple, but you have to have really good specialists for traumatized people or children like them. And then when you get there and you see children like on this picture, you see they're still able to smile and to have a good time, even after all they suffered from. So now the big problem, the Hashd al-Shaabi. First of all, the Hashd al-Shaabi, usually when you're talking about Shia militias and Hashd al-Shaabi, you use it as a synonym, but in fact it's a bit different. When in 2014, when the Iraqi army was imploding and they had 50 to 80% soldiers just gone, not killed but run away, the Iraqi government had the genius idea of just giving out weapons to everyone, because what could possibly go wrong? And so they said, of course, you can't just pick up a weapon. You have to fill in like this big formula and then you get a weapon. And you have a name. Have to have a name for your group. So it was like founding an association in Germany or a Dackelzüchterverein or something. But even that is more complicated in Germany than getting an Hashd al-Shaabi militia. So basically, when you had a group and a name, you went to like the next military office and said, well, this is the Enno and Kawa force and we want to fight here. Then they said, okay, help yourself, here are the weapons. Done. So what happened? Everybody got weapons. And most of these militias were backed by the Iranian forces, by the revolutionary forces. But often soldiers were Iranian soldiers were serving there, so it was a little bit like in Crimea, where we know no single Russian soldier has ever served in Crimea. They were there by accident, holidays, whatever, and that's basically the same what happened with the Iranian army and the Hashd al-Shaabi. There were also good people getting some of the weapons. Like some of the Yazidic people in Shingal, one of the groups there was also a Hashd al-Shaabi militia, got weapons, and that was a very good example how to work with that. But it's the single case, the one case I know where it went good, and that's it. So basically, the Iraqi army was giving the weapons or equipping the Iranian army to fight for or against, and there it's getting tricky. Sometimes the Hashd al-Shaabi, the Shia militias, were fighting with Peshmerga against IS, but only when IS got very close to the Iranian border. Then they said, hey, let's fight them together. And in the moment they pushed back Islamic State, Hashd al-Shaabi start fighting the Peshmerga.
By accident.
Yeah, a lot of accidents. You can't imagine this amount of accidents. And so when we were driving around there, we had to pass an Hashd al-Shaabi exclave, and our driver said, well, getting around is complicated. We can go through the exclave, but you're not allowed to film there. They're a bit weird, but please put the camera down. And so we said, okay, it's fine. Put the camera down. And when we were through the checkpoint, he said, okay, you can put the camera up, but hide it a little bit. Then he said, yeah, it's a shortcut. It's very nice because we save like 30 minutes. Yeah, and our last Christmas, they shot us here. That was hell of a fight, but I don't think that will happen today. Say, okay, you should told us that before. And he said, you see the bullet holes here? Yeah, a few friends of mine got killed here, but we got them out later. Said, yeah, okay. So
the distance was like 5 meters to 10 meters.
Well, really, it was a very narrow street. Like two cars could drive there next to each other, and on the one side being the Hashd al-Shaabi militias and on the other side the Peshmerga, and they were shooting each other with a caliber 50, so there were no walls left. Basically they cut the walls with the machine guns and then the walls fell over, and they also fought on the cemetery, which as they told me was handy because you could just leave the bodies there. And yeah. So then, of course, I ask, if you have these Hashd al-Shaabi areas within your areas, why don't you just nuke them or whatever? Then they said, well, the problem is there are a lot of civilians living there, our old neighbors, and we don't like them too much, but not everybody likes his neighbors. It's like everywhere. So we can't attack them or something. And the deal was, yeah, and of course, you don't want to. Why? Even in Germany, a lot of people sue their neighbors, but they're not shooting them. So it's basically the same. And so they said, okay, stay there. If you like, put on your own flags, have your own shops and whatever, and have checkpoints. That's fine for us. And then we just live next to each other. But then the Hashdar Shabi militia start putting weapons in and to put up bigger guns on top of the houses and stuff like that, which was not part of the deal. But then what do you do? Do you want to attack an area where civilians are living in? Then you have the same like in Gaza, where of course you have some terrorists there and a lot of civilians, and we see the mess there. So the Peshmerga said, of course, when we even start shooting, if we're firing there and we're killing only one civilian, then the civilians hate us, and then we have the next war within our city. So it doesn't make sense. So you somehow accept that they are breaking the deal and hope that it's going well, but it's not getting better. And so now you have the Iraqi army, which works together with the Hashdar Shabi, while the Hashdar Shabi are fighting the Peshmerga by accident very often. Like I think 2 weeks ago, the Hashdar Shabi were pounding with mortars on the Peshmerga in Shingal. And it's pretty simple. In the north are Peshmerga, in the south Hashdar Shabi. So if you shoot to the north, you're shooting Peshmerga. It's pretty simple. And they said, oh, sorry, we didn't watch the compass right or stuff like that. Sorry, guys. It happens again and again. So the Iraqi army is not fighting the Peshmerga, but by accident they're allied doing it all the time. So, and that's... just want to include this picture because we didn't know where to put it. This is a bomb defusing team. And the tools they have is like a wire cutter and a flashlight. That's all they got to defuse. And a knife, some of them, but not all of them. And that the tools with which they are defusing bombs, improvised explosive devices and stuff like that. And we were here and that were different kinds of bombs, road bombs, bombs to kill people, stuff like that. And here even in a bottle. And when you open the bottle or if you push it, then it explodes. And so with my food, I was moving them around to put them in the right direction for a picture. And then I said, so if I would like step on this, it would explode if it's not defused. And they say, well, actually, it's not defused yet. And the rest not either. So please move it carefully. And don't step on this because that somewhere under us is still a bomb, which we have to find it. So I said, okay, again, let's talk about what do you say before moving stuff and after moving stuff. Let's start. Not with what the names are, but what's going to blow up next. And all the stuff is really simple. It's not like a big bomb, you know, from a James Bond movie where you don't know which wire to cut. It's just explosives and something which has to have contact and then it blows up. And still, they don't have the right tools to work with it. And so when I wanted I tried to organize wire cutters for them and stuff like that, but that are dual use goods. They could be used as an army good, so you're not allowed to import them on an easy way. Stuff like that, so it's even hard to help those people. And so I knew this guy was cleaning the streets, which we will use now, so I have to trust him, while he only has a wire cutter and a knife to do his job. And in some parts of the roads where ISIS had a lot of IEDs in the ground, there were like 10 IEDs on 2 meters. And you just hope that he got all of them. And so that's again, they don't have the tools to do anything. So what's next in the next year and this year? Of course, Islamic State was driven out of most parts of Kurdistan, Iraq, but they are still in Iraq. They are still in Syria. And even when they got driven out there, then they will continue North Africa because they have a good setup running now, so they won't stop. Then you have the Islamic State legacy, like this stuff, all the bombs, the small stuff and so on. And they will blow up within the next years, maybe, even you have basically a peace treatment or whatever. Then the big thing is the Hashdar Shabi militia. Iran tries to gain influence in that region very aggressively, even with killing Peshmerga fighters and stuff like that. And so that's what I'm very worried about on the next time, within the next weeks, months, years, we don't know. And of course Baghdad, because Baghdad is desperately looking for an alliance to keep Kurdistan in its country. So if Baghdad has no power to fight the Peshmerga or to have any political tools or economy tools to push the Kurdish regional government, they could be so desperate that they cut a deal with the Iranian government and that they do the job. And so when IS is driven out, you know, in the last about 250 years we had a conflict zone there, and it's going to continue still with the same players, just the labels will change. So we will see what happens. So first of all, thank you. If you want to get in touch with us, ask us here. Here's some contact details. Now we have plenty of time for the question and answer, so this will, I guess, for most of you, the only chance to talk to a Peshmerga who was in service for years and actually fought Islamic State. Kawa talks German and English, so you can talk to him in German later as well. And of course, ask me if you want to know anything about the rest. So feel free to ask. And when you have a question, wait till you got one of the microphones.
Please wave. I have the mobile microphone with me. Who wants to get a question? First one, here you are.
Extremely naive question. What could happen that there will finally be some kind of peace in this region? Is there anything possible, or is this something completely stupid idea?
The idea is good, but well, other people had the idea before. I think the Kurdistan region has good chances to remain peaceful, but only because they drive out all the others. And the Islamic State is basically a money-making machine. It's not about religion. It's not about all the bullshit, Sunnis, Shia, whatever. They're making shitloads of money, hundreds of million in the last year. About 3 billion is the estimation, what they think at the moment. So it's like if you have a good running company, like you have Nestle, you're buying a lot of water from people, then you don't stop it. And if you're Islamic State, then you have a different business model. You're stealing oil and you're killing people and make ransom money. But why stop it? You're making money with it. So I don't think that it will stop. And on the other hand, people want to stay in power, like Assad wants to stay in power. The Iraqi government wants to stay in power. The Iranian government wants to stay in power. So I don't think that there's anything to settle, because there are too many parties fighting with each other all day long. So I think the Kurdistan region now has a chance to get peace. Turkey could have peace again, but only if Erdogan is gone. So then the peaceful region spreads a little bit, but I think that's it. I don't see, still don't see any solution for Iraq and the surrounding countries.
Thank you very much. Next question.
Thank you. Well, first of all, thank you very much for the presentation, and honor to the Peshmerga that are fighting there for Kurdistan. I'm curious about what in Kurdistan do they think of the Italian involvement. There are an Italian team there working at the Mosul Dam, helping rebuilding the dam, and also there are soldiers there officially protecting the technical teams. I was curious if you know more about what they're actually doing and what do you think of them, basically. What's your perception of them?
First of all, thank you very much for protecting the dam, because if this one gonna broke, there's a lot of people say gonna die. There was a long problem about it. They didn't was able to get into the facility like 1 year, and a half years. Wasn't able to fix the problems. So, of course, I like it. And I'm happy that there's a lot of volunteers coming over and helping. It's not just the Italians, it's also Netherlands and France. There's a lot of volunteers and NGOs that are coming and helping. But not every NGO is a good NGO.
Yeah, no, I'm
because I'm curious about
the
Italian, because I'm Italian. But they are actually Italian army over there.
Yeah, they're also in the training in Erbil.
And you have... oh, I forgot his name. AP are his initials. There is a trainer from, he was at the Italian army, and now he has a Erbil training center, ETC. And he's a young guy. He's, I think, in the late 20s, and he's training Peshmerga as well. And a lot of Peshmerga know him because he is a former Italian soldier. But as far as I see, they like everybody who's there. And of course, there are, I think, 12 nations now with only a few people. I think, of course, if you're an Italian engineer, you like to have protection by your own guys because you trust them. And maybe you just don't know anything of the region, so you don't know if it's a Peshmerga is trustworthy or not. But what I experienced there when I told them I'm from Germany, they always ask, oh, petrol company or soldier? They say, no, neither of them. but usually the people are very happy, and especially with the Mosul Dam, because it will would flood a lot of area. But as far as I know, the Italians have only like 50 or 100 soldiers also there, very little. Only around them. So that's no problem. While the US now have, I think, 3 or 4,000 Marines there. The German army has like 250 trainers and the others and stuff like that. So the people get used to it, and usually they are happy about everybody who's helping.
Enno, thank you first of all. You mentioned Erdogan, but otherwise you didn't talk about the role that Turkey is playing in that game. Could you elaborate that a bit more?
Yes. First of all, the Kurdish regional government and the Turkish government are pretty much friends. Not especially because of Erdogan, but because they have economic ties. The Kurdish government is exporting its oil over Turkey and stuff like that. And since now about 3 years, the Turkish army is training the Peshmerga in 4 training camps. So it's very weird if you see this Kurdish conflict within the Turkey that they're training the Peshmerga on the other side of the border. So there are now some 2,000 Turkish soldiers like between the Turkish border and around till Mosul, even with tanks and with really armed forces. They said they need the tanks to protect their own forces, who are there to protect the tanks or whatever. And they were also fighting at, they were not actually fighting, they were doing security stuff at the edge of the Mosul offensive as well. So as far as I know, they were not like really part of the fighting teams, but they backed them up. And of course, Turkey want to gain influence, I think, for 2 reasons. One reason is just money. At the moment, they have an exchange of money and goods of about $5 billion a year, which is a lot. You don't want to lose $5 billion of exports. And on the other hand, of course, influence. Every politician wants to have influence. But Erdogan especially, and especially with the Kurds in Iraq, because if you're friends with them and they declare independence, then you have to know that most of the Kurds in Iraq don't like the Kurds in Turkey, not personally, but politically. They have very different opinions. So if you make the ones stronger who don't, or who have different political views than the Kurds in your country, then you can make the gap between them bigger. I think that's also one of the reasons. So you have different reasons, but at the end, Turkey will win because they win influence, they win money and everything, while weakening the position of their own Kurds. And if there is a independent Kurdish state south of Turkey, then they can always say, why do you want to have independence? You already have a country. So no need to have independence in Turkey. I guess that's one of the reasons as well. That's at least what I assume.
Let me add a point on that. The Kurds are, on that point, they are like 50-50, because the half of the Kurds, they are under Barzani with the KDP. They are friends with the Turkey, and we got the PUK, the area where I am from. We are not so much okay with them because we don't like Erdogan and the AKP, and we don't see the Kurds from Turkey as terrorists. We see them as regular Kurds. So on that we are also a little bit, this is some of the problems he told you. In our region it's 50-50, so I would not say they are terrorists, because they even helped a lot, and they are even fighting on all sides.
Okay.
Hello. I have contact with some journalist in in Iraq right now. We are talking about much about the discussion. I talked once with you about this. So I have a question about the courts, because she has a she can't make it here, but she has a completely other point of view about this subject.
Okay.
And she says, as she has something is, but she doesn't. As she has, she thinks the Kurds, the Peshmergas, and these forces are much more weaker than we know.
Mm-hmm.
That was she is in the region right now. That that's her opinion. She says it's much more propaganda about the strange. Mostly she talked about the Bazani Peshmerga. It says that the we get much more about the strange military strange about the Peshmerga. That's much more PR than it's in fact. And also the ideas about Kurdistan. It's about what's her from her point of view, from also from her perspective. It's much more about it's more tricky. She said because she says, you shouldn't believe it. The problem is that the most Western journalists. What's her point of view? Just copy the things of Brazzani, and she says much. She says much is about this is bullshit. But it's interesting how the political system now the U.S. is, like you said, the both players are supporting it. But she says the problem about the Kurdistan is and why it will mostly fail because in the history of Kurdish people, of the internal problems is it. So I would like to know, will there be problems? Because she says also the neighbors will likely to have a lunch with this new country.
Am I allowed to ask if this person went with the Peshmergas? Did she spend time with them?
I know she is in. She was at the mosque. She participated as an embedded journalist at the Mosul offensive.
With the Iraqi army or with the Peshmerga?
I think with. I don't know. She don't tell me the exact. I think with the Iraqi army.
So there's a problem. You cannot. You cannot say the Kurds are so and so if you didn't go with the Kurds. I saw both sides. Something
I
you
don't,
have to be
I
very
don't
careful
know much.
About.
I don't know much about where she's what she's going exactly. But we can talk about it later, Kawa.
For me, it's pretty simple. If we jump back to the map, sorry for annoying like this. This area was covered by the Iraqi army.
Yeah.
This is already Syria. This. So, like this triangle was Iraqi army. IS came, Iraqi army ran away, and since that, Peshmerga are securing it. When the Iraqi army is the better part, why are the Peshmerga there? For me, the thing is simple. The next thing is, when did we have the last car bomb in Erbil? The last in Baghdad was yesterday, last week, the week before, 3 weeks before. And on the other hand, the area which was in the past protected by the Peshmerga was like somehow not exactly this one. It's still yellow. This was protected by the Iraqi army. This. So I will give her the point. The Peshmerga are very weak. I explained it to you. They have very bad equipment. They are not well trained and so on. So the Iraqi army has a way better training and they have much better equipment. And still they run away. So I give her the point that the Peshmerga are weak. But what does it tell us about the Iraqi army? So I don't think I agree with her. And the other thing is, I always hear Barzani has the big media outlet and everybody's copying from there. And when I ask what media outlet do they have, yeah, the one said they don't have one. They have, of course, they have a press conference and stuff like that. Nobody reads it. Then there's Rudau, the TV station, media station, which is a lot of it is founded by Barzani's. But then don't read it. There are other sources, or get there, like I do. I was on site with Rudau a few times by accident. We were on the few on the same spot, and there I could see what happened in reality and what was on TV later, and it was the same. So basically, I trust them, but that's my opinion. If you don't trust them, I'm fine. But it's like if you don't trust Bild-Zeitung, what do? You don't read it. Problem solved. And the next thing is, I also know when it starts with, but the Barzani's. And I say, you mean the $1 million clock he got? and the 250,000 euro car he gave to his nephew. This nephew just does not exist. It was a fake account on Instagram, and he doesn't wear a watch. But I agree he will hide the 1 million euro watch somewhere. and stuff like that. So it's always the same and repeating. And then when it comes to the point which Kawa said, have you met them? No. Because they are so untrustworthy, I don't want to meet them. That's okay. But then make up your own mind, visit them. I've seen the Iraqi army. I know why I don't trust them anymore since a few years now. And I know basically why I trust people like Kawa, because we had attacks, snipers fired at us, grenades, IEDs, everything. And at least I survived always. So I trust them. But even the political point, it's complicated, of course. But if you believe that people are following the propaganda, get there and write your own articles. We can do that. And then we will see.
Thank you very much. So we know they're weak, they're not well trained, but they're very brave to be there. So are there other questions? Just raise a hand. Yes. In the last corner. I will check.
Hello. I just only have one question. How do you finance your job there? Can you sell your stories, or you have donations, or?
That's a very interesting question. Still looking for a good solution for do so. Basically, it's like my holidays. Instead of going to a five-star resort to the Fijis or something, I'm going there. The most expensive part is the security equipment, and you're losing a lot of that stuff. I lost equipment for a few thousand euro in the last years there. Getting there is not too expensive. You can fly there and back for about between 500 and 1,000 euro. It depends. And then it depends on how much money you spend there. When I was there with Kawa, his general invited me to sleep in the base, which was very handy. It was quite an experience. Yeah, and he bought a bed for me, really. He ordered a bed and somebody to set it up. So we were the only ones having beds. But very kind, of course.
Let me tell you, I didn't get a bed before. Yeah. They just give him a bed and the other ones. They say if people like Enno come to Kurdistan and help us and are talking about our issues, at least we will give you a nice room and we will have a bed for you.
We were somewhere here, really in the south. We had then an issue with the only shower, which is also the toilet, because somebody tried to fix the dropping or the leaking hose. To make a long story short, the kitchen and the toilet were underwater and we had to switch off water for the whole compound. And there is no do-it-yourself market in about 10 hours car ride. So it ended up with a broomstick, gaffer tape and plastic bags and a big hammer. And yeah, but that's basically how you get there cheap. And then it's like 1,000, 1,500 euro for a week, which is like an expensive holiday. I'm financing it on my own. I don't really sell my stories, not because I don't want to, but because I'm not good in selling the stories. And I'm like, I never learned how to write properly. So I write it in the way I do. I'm blogging for fun. And so for doing it for a newspaper, it must match a lot of criteria, and I must ask a lot of people if they want to have it and have the pictures in the right way and stuff like that. So I just don't know how to do it. And so, yeah, basically I'm too lazy. So the financing for me is just paying it from the money I earn with my job and doing it in my holidays.
So, thank you. So we've heard a bed is the luxury in the eye of the storm. So another question, just raise a hand if you want to have the microphone. No one anymore? Okay, then thank you very much. It was
thank you.
Very inspiring, very interesting. And we've got great insights. So, something organizational. We will now be having a short lunch break till 1:30, followed up by the next Big data and its impact on the modern society will be the next panel. Please gather together here at 1:30. Thank you.
Ja, klar, natürlich. Sei mir nicht böse, wenn ich so geantwortet habe.
Nein, hallo.
Das ist immer das Gleiche, weißt du?
Ich habe noch eine Frage, die ich nicht öffentlich stellen wollte. Was von den Dingen, die du hier erzählt hast, war so halt schon mal gescheitert? Das glaube ich nicht. Als die Geschichte mit den Flüchtlingskindern, die so auf Englisch sprechen, die haben wir schon tausendmal gehört, aber ich habe Kontakt mit Flüchtlingskindern hier in Deutschland und da ist vielleicht eins unter tausend.
Also es sind nicht, nein, es sind bei weitem nicht alle. Das sind wirklich, ich würde sagen,